It didn't manage to skew it even for the tiny, tiny little bit. You see, and here are you see, all the malicious sensors got weight zero, essentially, almost zero. And I think the, which one is W1, is, let's see, the blue one is the estimation of the variances using this algorithm. So that's to answer your question. In the presence of highly non-stochastic errors, this guy actually performed remarkably well. But for some distribution of variances, it breaks down. So then people tried somehow to find an algorithm that in the presence of any distribution of variances produces optimal, almost maximum likelihood results, but still retains total immunity to various types of attacks, as we will see, right? So that's the goal. So how do we solve this problem? Well, one can argue as follows. How can we write this expression here? Let's write it. So can you just... this expression can be written as follows. Say, estimate I plus first estimate, right, at instant t, is equal weighted mean, I goes from 1 to n, n, and then we have reciprocal of the variance. Let's expand it. What is this? This is 1 over, and then 1 over total number of measurements, and then sum. Say j goes from 0 to n, n, and then here its readings of the sensor, sorry, this is t goes, I'm asleep, t goes from instant 1 to instant dt, right, and then readings of the ith sensor and instant t minus estimate ith estimate, right, squared divided by mean of all these reciprocals. So it will be sum j equals from 1 to n, n of of 1 over, and then 1 over tt, sum t equals from 1 to tt, and then here we will have readings j t minus here estimate, of course, a t, estimate previously obtained at t, and then squared times readings of the sensor I at instant t, right? What is this factor here? This factor here is essentially, so 1 over, 1 over, well, let's write it like this. Let's just see what is this. So 1 over tt times sum of t equals from 1 to tt of readings I at instant t minus estimate previously obtained I, and then squared. What is this? This is equal 1 over tt, and this is distance, Euclidean distance, squared between the readings of I and estimate. So the distance, Euclidean distance squared, right? Because we will have to take. So it simply mean distance of the readings of that sensor to the current value of the estimate. And so we simply make the weight inversely proportional to this distance. But we saw that taking reciprocal is bad because reciprocal has a pole here, and for some values of the variance, for some data, it can converge to just the values of, sorry, the value of a single sensor. So people try to remedy by adding a small epsilon here, so that you avoid this explosion near the pole. Well, guess what? In order for this to be robust, epsilon cannot be very, very small. And once epsilon is not very small, this starts looking more and more like a simple mean. So you have this conflict between accuracy and robustness, and this often happens in iterative methods, right? So this was a bad idea, even though people did use it. So this was done by this physicist, Loretti and company, and then two guys, De Kershoff and Van Doren, I think their names are, came up with the following idea. You want a weight function that is inversely related to the distance, right? So instead of, I guess no one uses the boards. So instead of using a reciprocal of mean distance squared, instead of that, they propose the following: max mean distance distance either squared or not squared, there are several versions, minus mean distance of I sensor. So this is the weight of sensor I here, mean distance of I squared here. So you take simply, and let me show you how they do it. So rather than, let's see, let's go back to the first file, second file. So, here is what they do. So, in original Loretti business, you simply take reciprocals of the variance, which is reciprocal of the mean distance, right? Because this is, what is the estimation of variance? It's the mean distance squared between the readings of that sensor and current estimate of the value. Instead, these two guys proposed the following, the weights are not reciprocals of this distance. Right? So this distance I here would be, I could have written it, is the variance, right? Because that's what the mean distance is, right? So they instead do the following. They take maximal distance of all sensors. So you see which sensor produced is farthest away from the true readings, and then you subtract the distance of the ith sensor. So this will be, if the distance is small, then this difference will be large. If the distance is large, this will be small. And of course, when for the largest, for the guy that is farthest away, he will get weight zero. Right? So instead of penalizing, right, let me. So instead of penalizing in this way, right, we will use the following formula. We will use the estimate. I plus 1 of t is sum, it's a weighted sum of readings of all sensors, but instead of this, we will have max of 1 over tt times sum t goes 1 to tt of readings of I sensor at instant t minus estimate that was produced in the previous stage of iteration of t squared. So this is the mean. In fact, you know, because we even don't need this, because it will be used. Let's really remove it. Just max of this, because it will be also appears in the denominator, so it cancels out. So max of all of these over all possible, let's call it j. Right, j goes between 1 and nn, minus sum t equals from 1 to tt of readings, and this is closed here, so max of this minus readings of ith sensor at t minus estimate at t and then squared. And then here on the top will be sum over all k between 1 and n between, so k equals to from 1 to nn of exactly above for all t. So just normalize, it's all of these guys for all sensors summed up to normalize the weights to 1. So you see here, you penalize by reciprocal of the distance. Here you penalize by the difference between the largest distance of the worst sensor and the distance of your sensor up. Yeah? Right? And let's see how this performs when in this first for case equals to 1. Oh, here are the names of the authors of this. So let's see for the case when the when the reciprocals behave well, let's see how this algorithm, how it performs. So if you look, so this is the error of maximum likelihood. This is the error of the best sensor. Reciprocal works well, and lo and behold, the affine is only slightly worse, right? Now let's see if we do the case when the reciprocal can perform bad, and not necessarily always, but when you have equally spaced variances. So let's see how well it performs. So it doesn't always break the reciprocal this case, but it often does, as you can see if you... Okay, let's see what happened here. Look, the reciprocal broke down because it produced variance equal to the best sensor. And affine stayed quite close to maximum likelihood. So it looks like the problem is solved. But what do you think? What's the Achilles heel of this method? When it will really behave badly, it has also a case when it will perform pretty awfully. When will this not be a good weight? The difference between maximal distance of among all sensors and that given sensor. Yes?
Possibly when the largest distance is a major outlier.
Exactly. If you have one, so one single guy can screw you up totally. Because if you have one bad outlier, then only he will get weight zero. All other guys will get approximately the same weights. Right? Because the variance between this and that will be huge, right? So the value of this difference will be more or less just this. So all the sensor get the same weight except the outlier. So let's see how that this in fact happens. So if you put here case number three, notice case number three does the following. It's, I took it here to be, let's take it, let's try this one. So you see, in the case three, you have these variances of all sensors, and then a gigantic variance for the very last sensor. So variance of 20, well, here, let's evaluate it. So you see here, the variances are relatively small, and the last variance is huge, right? 20 compared to about 2. So let's see what results we get. So this guy broke down because the variances are equally spaced, so it picked up this guy. Oh, what happened here? Affine didn't. Oh no, affine also was badly influenced by, because this is quite far from this. Let's get an even worse outlier instead of 20 variants, right? Let's take 100. Well, let's take 200 because it's easy to add a zero. Oops. So if you have really huge variance, now let's see what you get. You can see the variance is huge because he can be an attacker, right? So look what happens. Now reciprocal actually performed reasonably well, but here the variance of the affine was pretty bad because all what they did, look what the weights are. So the reciprocal weight tracked the optimal maximum likelihood weight in this case pretty well. Look what affine did. It gave equal weight to everyone except to the outlier. Right? So the problem is actually not solved at all. It is in fact resilient to malicious reporting, but statistically it doesn't perform well at all. So it, both methods have Achilles heels, right? And yet this is really, it's good, especially for this online kind of aggregation of online data. You would really want to have something that does better. So you need something that will not be skewed terribly by one single large outlier, and that doesn't have poles, right? So, what do we do in this situation? So I had my students, another guy who took the course several years back, we devised the following algorithm. Okay, so the point is this, we have an algorithm that performs pretty well. In fact, we thought it was almost bullet proof. And in fact, it was this student of mine and myself, we published it, quite a few centers that deal with this data aggregation on the web were trying to break it down, and they couldn't. And then last year, a student broke it down within 2 days after he saw it in class, Ishraq Huda. He's a really very brilliant young man. I don't know whether it's a kind of how serious the flaw is. I changed the algorithm, but I didn't perform Ishraq's attack. I just, this I do on a side. I do signal processing. This I do kind of just with my students for them to have something to work on, like in the, for this class. But the point is this. It's a kind of work is in progress. You will see implementations of several algorithms, including the one that Ishraq broke last year. Your goal is, I've tried to fix it, I don't know if the fix works. What you can do is, you can try to break the algorithm by a clever kind of collusion attack, which you will see how, and maybe make it better. Right? And if it's a really good result, it, as I say, this is like, this former student of mine published, I think, like 3 papers so far with different applications and different versions, mostly kind of for online business. Yes, so the point is, here is challenge for you, break down the latest algorithm and try to make it even more robust and more accurate. You can try to incorporate more sophisticated statistical methods, but in a way that will preserve resiliency towards collusion attacks. And this is what you will see. So how does the latest version of UNSW algorithm that I actually fixed it just a couple of days ago when I was preparing the files for you to play with. And let's see how we penalized here the distance. Here it is. What is the penalty? So what do you want to achieve? You want to avoid walls. And you want to avoid that one guy can skew the whole thing, right? There are other pitfalls as well. Let me erase this and tell you what the idea is. Actually, this is much simpler than the algorithm we published. And the, how did we get this algorithm? By stumbling in the darkness. So it's pretty much a kind of heuristics and a hack. But you will see how well it performs. So what is the idea? You use the following penalty function. You use exactly what's written here. What is, so the weight, so let's see. So for reciprocal, the weight, so the weights for the reciprocal, the weight is of course normalized to sum equal to 1 of 1 over tt, but this is in fact not necessary because it will cancel out with the bottom, right? It's t equals from 1 to tt of the reading of the sensor I at t minus estimate at t squared, right? And we saw this is bad because this has a pole at 0. Affine, which is this one, the weight is, so what is this? This is the weight of sensor R, right? And then estimate is simply sum of weight of sensor I divided for normalization of weights of all sensors J times the readings of the I sensor at T, right? That's the estimate. Right, so we are talking about these weights. So affine, it's a max of sum of readings of sensor J T minus estimate T squared when max taken over all sensors J minus sum, and here is t is equal from 1 to tt, sum t equals from 1 to tt, and then here will be readings of the ith sensor t minus estimate t squared, right? This is the affine weight, and it gets screwed when this is very large because everyone gets about the same weight. So UNSW latest is the following. It is e to the power minus, and then here is variance of sensor I divided by, divided by mean of all variances. So what is, if the variance of one sensor becomes extremely small, this becomes zero, e to the zero, this is max of this is smaller than one, right? When this is zero, it becomes one. If variance of a sensor is significantly larger than the average variance of the sensors, this will be large, so e to something large will be small, right? And let's see how, so it's a hack. And you will see in the files several versions of it that kind of evolved with time. And your goal is try to beat them. So let's see how well we perform. So let's see first. So this, when it stabilizes with this weight, you don't take the estimate, you only take estimations of variances, and then you use max likelihood single shot estimation. So let's see how well we perform. How well do we perform? So first case is the case with all random variances where everyone should perform really pretty good. Let's see, did we get? You see, this is maximum likelihood, the gold standard. This is the best. Reciprocal obviously does extremely good job. Affine is a bit worse, and we are essentially equally good as the reciprocal, but we converge faster. You see the number of rounds of iteration for our weight is 8 and here is 12. So everyone does good job when things are kind of randomly distributed. Let's see what happens when we take case 2 that screws up the reciprocal weight. So if we run it, what happens? It doesn't always destroy the reciprocal weight. It's again, you know, stochastic thing is you can never guarantee, but most of the time it does. So let's see what happens there. Reciprocal still perform pretty good, but our weight variance is even smaller. So let's run it again to try to make the reciprocal to break down. It doesn't always break down, but look, it's 71 rounds of iteration versus only 8. So let's see what we get here. Now we got, reciprocal broke down. You see, because it got variance that is equal to the best sensor. This guy got 0.26, not bad, but look at our weight. We stayed close to optimum. And this is actually very interesting. These are the weights. The blue is the reciprocal. It converged to just the lowest variance sensor, and everyone else gets zero. Red is the gold standard optimal distribution of weights by maximum likelihood if you knew the variance. Magenta. Magenta is the affine. It's not bad, but far away from the optimal. And look at our weight. It is almost perfect, right? So let's now try to do the case when it breaks down because of a large outlier. So I put here 60, that should be good enough. Let's see, case 3, if we run it, let's see how do we perform. Now the affine should completely break down, right, because of a large outlier. Okay, let's see what we got. Reciprocal broke down. Affine also broke down, but not catastrophically because it got 0.27. But look, we are almost unaffected, right? So what are the weights now? So the reciprocal totally broke down. Affine essentially broke down because it gave equal weight to everyone except the last one. And we remain extremely close to the maximum likelihood. Okay, so let's see how much time do we have left. There is another thing that we want to look for, namely the performance when the attack is actually very smart. Let's see, what is a very smart attack? And this was invented by my former student who took the class maybe 3-4 years ago. And let me show you what he did. This is how the attack works. So you have a bunch of sensors, and they produce their readings with some variances, right? So they are not smack accurate, but they are reasonably accurate. Then you have 5 attackers, and they do the following clever trick. Say, 4 of them report very large values, right? And the 5th one listens to other sensors or from their own measurements, estimates the mean of this reading and these readings, and reports that mean. So the skewing will not be so catastrophic, but will be large, because to the system, it will appear that he is closest to the truth, because he is smacking the mean of all readings. You understand the trick? Right? So, 4 guys, this is why it's collusion attack. 4 guys report outliers, 5th guy reports the mean and essentially pretends that he is the best one. So let's see what happens in this case. Oh, come on. Okay. In this case, look, the reciprocal got totally, you can see he gave all the weight to the attacker. Right? The affine got pretty badly skewed, not terribly, like, because he gave 1 weight to everyone, including the 5th attacker. And look what our algorithm does.